lot of the conventional wisdom in the financial markets these days is, you know, investing in the S&P 500 for your stock market exposure, just, you know, like the Vanguard S&P 500 fund, and just buy that and hold it. And, you know, you can't time the market, so just hold it and keep it, and 20, 30 years from now, let's hope it went up in value. I want to talk about, you know, when that's a good idea and if that's a good idea, and we're going to look at some statistics. I've always believed that if you know how to read a historical chart and you extrapolate the data correctly, you're going to be a more informed investor, and you're going to make a logical decision as opposed to an emotional decision. So let's take a look, and instead of following just the conventional wisdom, the timeless wisdom, and I put that in quotes, I'm going to look at actual figures. You see, because even though you can't really time the market on an hourly or daily basis, we do know from plenty of historical data that when we invest in the stock market, when price-to-earning ratios are low, meaning that when corporations are earning more money and their prices are lower than historical averages, we're going to perform a lot better than times when we invest when the inverse is true, when prices are higher relative to how much a company is making. That's really the bottom line of what drives values in stocks. What's driving the price of a stock? Earnings. It's all about corporate earnings. So let's start by looking at the returns by style. You see over here, if you were to look since the market bottomed in March of 2009, you see that your small cap stocks, your stocks that are $1 billion, $2 billion in size, you know, 140-150% returns. Your mid-sized stocks, $2 to $10 billion in market size, not bad. Not as well over here on the large cap, your big mega cap companies, $10, $20, $100 billion companies, not done quite as well as their mid-small cap counterparts. You'll notice on the small and the growth, or the value versus the growth, not a lot of disparity. The value on the mid-cap size has done a little bit better, but not really a big difference there. So we're going to talk about the biggest 500 stocks, which has some of each of these in them. So we're going to start with, looking at the last 14, 15 years in the S&P. And here are the 500 biggest stocks. And what we're looking at is if you go to 97, you see we had a nice run up, 106% return. Market gave all of that back, 49% loss. Then it made all of that back over the next 5 years for 101% gain. And what happens, the way compounding interest numbers really just work, is when you lose 50%, you have to get 100% just to get back to break even. And so when we lost a 57% market share in 2008 and 9, even the 101% gain run-up that we've had here was not enough to even get back to break even. So we still are at a lower price-to-earnings ratio than we were at when the market peaked in 2007. You see, we were at 15 times earnings here. Today, we are at 12 times earnings. Over here, you look back at 2000, we were at 25 times earnings, a very dangerous time to invest. And then down here, 14 times earnings, it worked out pretty well. So the point here, and we're going to look at some historical charts, is when we invest when price-to-earning ratios are lower, we generally have a lot more success. And right now, as you can see, forward price to earnings, the price of a stock divided by what it's earning, is this number that's so critical. So as you look here at historical rebounds, you know, we've just had a devastating blow, a 57% loss in the stock market over 17 months. The average bull run, when stocks are doing well, when we're in an economic expansion, is 176% return versus the average loss since 1946, a 35% drop. Now there's a couple things that you can deduce from this study, and that is, number one, stocks go up a lot more than they go down. So it's in, you know, if you were in Vegas, you know that the every type of gambling venture that they have, the odds are tilted in their favor. Well, in this case, if we go back, we could simply say that, okay, the winters in the stock market are on average 14 months long, and the summers are on average 68 months long. Those are pretty good odds. The average winter, we lose 35%. The average harvest or summer brings us 176% return. That's pretty good as well. And of course, you know, over 2.2 years, that's a pretty good return. Well, right now we've already made 101% in this market that began in March of 2009. If we were to be in line with the historical average, we would have another 75% to go. But there's even a more important number than these historical figures, which do put things into context, because you certainly can't trust the media to put things into context. Really, the media is all meaningless and irrelevant when you're looking at statistical data, because they skew everything, and mostly bad news is what's selling, and so they're you know, fear mongers, really. Not an investor's friend by any sense. Take a look here at the price to earnings now, we've talked about is 12.3, versus the 5-year average is 13, so not too far off. The last 5 years have all been pretty rough. The 10-year average is 14. That's a pretty good difference. That's, you know, about 17-18% difference. But the 15-year average on the S&P 500 is 16 times earnings. Right now, again, remember, we're at 12 times earnings. The price of a stock compared to its book value is 2 compared to a historical average of 3. That's a big difference. Price to cash flow. Now think of this. If a bank is loaning you money, they want to know how much is the price of the house relative to your cash flow. And the latest is 8.5 and the historical is 11.1. So again, if you look at the historical valuations here, price to earnings ratio seem pretty low. Average 16.2 over the last 20 something years. Right now it's at 12, so very low. Now, let me point out that that's just investing in the S&P 500. You can go a step further when you're looking at valuations. You remember from the first chart we looked at, the small cap value stocks had done the best since the market bottomed in March of 2009. Well, if you look here, small value stocks have done better, and so they are closer to their historical valuation. So yes, the historical S&P has been a 16 times earnings, but that doesn't mean that mid-company stocks are 16, they were 14. Large growth stocks have historically been extremely expensive. Mid-growth stocks very expensive at 21.8 times earnings. And so if you look here, you'll notice that large growth stocks, which is where my portfolio is the heaviest, is where we have the biggest disparity between historical range of where stocks are trading relative to how much money they're making, the most important factor when you're buying a stock. When you're buying any business, how much money is the business making net of all expenses? And then you put a multiple on it. Well, we do the same thing in the stock market. And so we look at these growth stocks and we say, boy, right now they're trading at 13.8 times earnings. That is a 34.3% discount from where they historically have traded. That's very cheap. If a building is normally $1 million and you can go in and buy it for $650,000, that is a discount relative to its historical value. That's a very good bargain. So as we look at stocks right now, we find that they're at a bargain. Generally, this is correlated to the consumer confidence. It's correlated to how well of a job the media is doing, and these days the media can just get anywhere really fast and is giving this message of carnage on the streets and blood in the streets and scaring a lot of people. So there's this record amount of money in cash and in bonds, pushing these bond rates to unusually and just ridiculously low yields. Here's what happens. When you have you know, a year like 98, 99, where the stock market's off the up, you know, just through the roof, 50, 60% returns over a couple of years, we have people throwing money into domestic equity funds. Well, remember what happened in the next 3 years, 2000, 2001, 2002, the stock market crashes. People in 2001, 2002 are barely putting any money in, and in reality they're taking money out in 2002, which is right before the stock market starts to go up again. Well, look what's happened to equity funds flow into the stock market for all intents and purposes from 2006 through year-to-date 2012, and you see that people are taking a lot of money out of the stock market. Well, where are they putting it? they're putting it to the tune of billions of dollars a month into the taxable bond market, earning 3% and 4% yields. Here we've got we're on the precipice of one of the biggest bond bubbles we've ever seen, and people are just throwing money into the taxable bond. The crowd is almost always wrong. If you do no more, as Warren Buffett says, then zig when everyone else zags, and zag when everyone else zigs, you're going to outperform the markets if we go back and take that historical strategic approach. So, as you consider whether or not you should be in the stock market, consider that right now the crowd, in the last 6 years, has put $1.2 trillion, $1,207 billion into bond funds since 06, and they've put $200 billion into stock funds and ETFs, exchange-traded funds since 2006. So the money's going into taxable bonds. Why? Because of fear. They're afraid of all the reports that keep coming out. And in that period of time, the net effect of this money going into the place where, from a price to earnings and from a valuation standpoint, doesn't make any sense on paper. But that's where the money's going, and it's created an anomaly. It's created stocks, such as large growth stocks, trading at a 35% discount. That is a huge discount for stocks. So should you invest in the S&P 500? Valuations don't lie. The media lies all the time. If you look at your sources, the internet, and you're looking for the latest article of what earnings came out yesterday, usually those earnings are going to be skewed, and one quarter is certainly much less important than a trend. And so when we're looking at the macro numbers of what is the price to earnings ratio, it looks to be a great bargain right now, with price to earnings sitting as low as they are in the stock market.